Often, we base our credit scoring models on statistical analysis of historical data. We try to find a statistical relationship between an attribute value and the default. An attribute is a characteristic of the loan or the client. Examples of attributes are gender, business activity, age, and so on. We could find that certain business activities or age groups tend to default more often. This is useful information that we can include in our scoring model. We have made videos on Bayesian and logistic regression scoring. Both scoring approaches use historical loan data. It could also be that there is no relation between the attribute and the defaults. Of course, we are looking for those attributes that have the most predictive power. The chi-square test offers a nice tool to select the right model attributes. Let us have a look. In our test data set, we have 1,000 loan records. 950 clients reimbursed their loans to the bank. Then, 50 clients defaulted on their obligations. 1,000 client dossiers, 950 non-defaulted, 50 defaulted. So, our historical data tell that there are 50 defaulters out of 1,000 dossiers. Hence, the probability of default is 50 over 1,000. This is 5%. These numbers and this percentage apply to the complete data set. Now we are going to look at the attributes. Our data set includes 4 attributes. 1. Gender. 2. Activity. 3. Age, and 4. Family situation. Each of these attributes can take different values. For business activity, for example, we have agriculture, commerce, industry, and so on. These are categorical data. Each dossier belongs to one category. We also have numerical data such as age. Here we group the data in classes or bins. Under 20, between 20 and 30, and so on. This way the numerical data become categorical data. Next step is to count the number of dossiers for each of these categories. Looking at gender, we have 700 male and 300 female clients. Adding these two numbers, we get, of course, 1,000. We repeat this exercise for all attributes: activity, age, and family situation. In the next step, we look at the number of defaulters per category. Looking at the attribute gender, we see there are 50 defaulters. This leads to a probability of default of 5%. No surprises here. Zooming in on the categories, male and female, we see that this PD percentage varies per category. For the men, we get 39 defaults out of 700 dossiers. This produces rounded a PD of almost 6%. For the women, this percentage is rounded close to 4%. We might conclude that giving loans to men is more risky than lending to women. We do the same analysis for the other attributes. Remember, the probability of default for the population is 5%. We notice that certain categories have high default rates. For instance, the sectors commerce and industry are risky. Also, lending to bachelors, families without offspring, and to youngsters carries much risk. But we must be careful. After all, it could be that our conclusions are the result of a random data variation. How to distinguish between data volatility and statistical evidence? We need a tool here. The chi-square test is the right instrument. The test tells us whether our conclusions have statistical relevance. Is randomness the cause of the spikes, or is there a pattern? Let's find out. We focus on the business activity. There are 5 business areas. We have agriculture, commerce, industry, services, and crafts. It is clear that commerce and industry show a high default risk. The test hinges on the comparison between the numbers we expect and those we observe. Agriculture, for example. In our dataset, there are 182 farmers. Since the PD equals 5%, we would expect 5% of the farmers to default. This would be circa 9 farmers. We do this calculations for all sectors for both defaulters and non-defaulters. The sum of all cases equals again 1,000. The actual numbers are as follows. For the chi-square value, we need to do the following for each of the cases. 1. We take the actual value and subtract the expected value. We need to do this for all cases. So, for the 5 sectors and for the defaulted as well as the non-defaulted cases. 2. We square the results. This squaring has 2 advantages. It eliminates negative numbers. All squared values are positive. Furthermore, it emphasizes the differences that become even bigger when squared. 3. In the next step, we divide by the actual value. This way the data becomes standardized. 4. We sum all elements. This gives us the chi-squared value. In our case, the sum equals 48.78. To understand what this value means, we look at the chi-squared distribution. By the way, chi is a letter of the Greek alphabet. It looks like a capital X, but in the pronunciation chi is a combination of the letters C and H. The first two letters of the name Christ are written in Greek as one letter, the chi. Since we are talking about letters and spelling, you can write chi-square or chi-squared. Both are correct. Alright, back to the chi-squared distribution. It is important to develop some intuition for this distribution. We saw that the chi-square value increases as the difference between the actual and expected values increases. We see the chi-squared distribution for 4 degrees of freedom. We return to these degrees of freedom in a bit. For now, it is important to see that the distribution is skewed. There is a long, thin tail pointing to the right. The mean value of the distribution equals the number of degrees of freedom. So, the mean is 4. The mode of a chi-square distribution equals the mean minus 2. We see indeed that the highest probability, so the top of the graph, is at 2. We found a high chi-squared of 49. We see that this value is way to the right in the tail. This is far away from the distribution's mean and mode. Large differences between the actual and expected values drive this high value. Intuitively, we see that the attribute does not follow the expected pattern. Hence, we suspect that this economic activity helps to spot defaulters. We need to quantify this suspicion beyond reasonable doubt. A percentage can express this confidence level. Say we are aiming at 95%. So, we want to be 95% sure about our conclusions. We only accept an error margin of 5%. The area under the curve represents all possible outcomes. The sum covers 100% of the surface. Now we are splitting the graph in 2 parts. The left part that represents 95% of the graph surface. And the right part that represents 5% of the surface. Values to right, beyond this cutoff point, are outliers. They are far away from the distribution center. Beyond this point, we conclude that there is no longer statistical randomness, but we assume a pattern. In our case, a link between the variable and defaulting. How to find this cutoff point? Excel has a function for the chi-square distribution. But first, we need to return to the concept of degrees of freedom. The number of degrees of freedom equals the number of independent options. In our example table, we have 1. Along the top horizontal row, 2 options. Non-default and default. 2. Along the vertical axis, we have 5 industries. 2 times 5 equals 10 possible combinations. This does not, though, equal the degrees of freedom. Key is that the options have to be independent. If you know a client is a defaulter, this implies that he is not a non-defaulter. Although there are 2 options, there is only 1 degree of freedom. Knowing that your client is not active in agriculture, commerce, industry, or services necessarily leads to crafts. For this reason, we always subtract 1 from the number of options. Our 2x5 matrix contains 4 degrees of freedom. With this concept explained, we can return to the Excel function. This function returns the value on the x-axis for the chi-square distribution. In our case, the inputs are 95% for the probability and 4 for the degrees of freedom. We find the point 9.49. To the left of the point, we find 95% of the graph surface. To the right, 5%. We use the 95% as a threshold. Values beyond this point in the right-hand tail are extreme values. We conclude that these cannot be explained by random variation. For the attribute economic activity, we find a chi-squared value of almost 49. This is way beyond the cutoff point of 9.49. We have an extreme value in the right-hand tail. Statistical variation cannot explain this value. Hence, we conclude that there is a meaningful relationship between defaults and economic sector. In other words, economic sector is a good attribute to include in our model. Let's look at a second example, gender. We calculate the expected values as if the default rate is the same for both sexes. We compare this with the actual values. For each combination, we calculate the difference between the actual and expected values. We square the result and then divide this by the expected value. The last step is to take the sum of all values in the matrix. This leads to the chi-squared. We get a chi-squared of 1.6. As for the degrees of freedom, we see that there are two options on the horizontal axis. Non-default and default. There are two options on the vertical axis, male and female. We need to subtract one for each axis. We left with 1 times 1 equals 1 degree of freedom. We use the Excel chi-square inverse function again. And we find that 95% are cut off at 3.84. To the left of this point we find 95% of the graph surface. The chi-squared value for gender is 1.60. This is to the left of the threshold and close to the distribution's mean of 1. In other words, this is a common value. We conclude that the chi-square value is within the range of regular variation. Hence, gender is not a good predictor for our default model. The chi-squared is often combined with hypothesis testing. The starting hypothesis is that defaults have an even distribution for both sexes. The alternative hypothesis is that the distribution is uneven. In the latter case, this means that the attribute is useful for our model. With the chi-squared test, we can evaluate the attribute's predictive power. Business activity, age, and family situation are good attributes for our model. Gender is not a good attribute to include in our default model. The chi-squared distribution approach is a tool to select attributes for a model. The approach indicates whether the attribute has predictive power. In this video, we learned the background of this distribution. We got a feel for the intuition behind it. Moreover, we learned how to apply this method in practice for default prediction models. Good luck!